Welcome to the Long Island Pine Barren Society program. I'm Dick Amper.
And I'm Kathleen Nesta.
And today we're going to be talking about government, and we're talking about both from today and yesterday. And our guests are assembly members from the New York State Legislature. They are Fred Thiele and Steve Englebright. But first, we'd like to introduce you to Tom Casey. Tom Casey's a board member of the Pine Barren Society, and he wants to show you a place that you really might enjoy in the Pine Barrens, Manorville Hills. So let's take a look.
Thanks, guys. Manorville Hills County Park offers one of the longest expanses of roadless land on Long Island. This is a place that offers a sense of wilderness and solitude, a place where you can wander all day and not retrace your steps. Long abused by off-road vehicles, the terrain here is badly eroded in some places, but better management and a fine system of new trails is helping to reclaim these classic pine barrens. You'll find a convenient trailhead on the east side of County Route 111, south of LIE Exit 70, at Hot Water Street. There's plenty of parking and access to separate marked trails for hikers, mountain bikers, and horse riders. A yellow-blazed hiking trail offers a flat, shady walk, partly lined with thick stands of ferns. Some non-native and invasive plants survive on what was once a farm, but field succession is slowly returning it to a more natural state. Beyond a stand of white pine, the trail soon reaches an orange-blazed loop trail. Pick a direction. Traveling clockwise, you'll reach a kettle hole, a depression in the earth left over from the Ice Age. Beyond, the trail travels up and down the convoluted Manorville Hills, deposited as part of the Ronkonkoma Moraine by the receding glaciers. Elevations top out at 250 feet, and you'll find occasional viewpoints through the trees. The loop will take you on a journey of 7 miles, but side trails and old fire roads create infinite possibilities for longer or shorter walks, as does an almost 10-mile section of the long-distance Pamunak Path, which also passes through the park. If you care to explore, bring a map and compass and plenty of water, especially in warmer weather. Manorville Hills can be a harsh environment at times, but a visit here is always memorable. Back to you.
Thanks,
hey,
Tom.
Thanks, Tom. So, the New York State Legislature, most of our viewers know that it has been part Republican, part Democrat, the senators being Republicans and the assembly members being Democrats. That changed this year for the first time in a long time. And both houses are controlled by Democrats. Can we start right there and find out, is that good? Is that bad? Has it made any difference? Is it just causing confusion? Let's start with you.
Well, first of all, it's good. Second of all, it has perhaps brought about the most significant change in state government, probably at least in the 24 years that I've been a member of the state assembly.
And that is?
Well, there was a number of important environmental bills. Let's just start with the environment, but you could say that about social legislation, education, you pick the topic, but proposals, good proposals that would get stuck in the other
politically,
house.
You couldn't politically get support, and now you don't need the same kind of support, so you can get more done.
Yeah, exactly. You know, the kind of the backlog of good progressive environmental legislation that you know, we would pass in the assembly. I mean, the most frequent words that Assemblyman Englebright and I would say when people would ask me what happened with the environment this year is, well, we passed that bill in the assembly, but it didn't go anywhere in the Senate. And that was the refrain often on issue after issue. And I think that's the biggest change.
Okay. From your view, from your perspective?
Fred is absolutely spot on. We have almost 15 bills at this point. Session's not over yet, but we are making great progress. Last year, we had 0 bills coming out of the Environmental Committee of the Assembly that were passed in the Senate. Every one was either held hostage or, for various reasons, declined to be even be taken up in the Senate. This year, Senator Todd Kominski has taken over the chairmanship. He used to be
from Long Island.
From Long Island, and he used to be on the committee with Fred and I, and now he's the chair in the Senate, and he's doing some really wonderful and thoughtful things with his chairmanship, including protecting children from toxic substances and helping to push through a statewide ban on plastics for bags in the supermarkets and right down the line. It's been
so. Would you say that the state government is working even if the federal government isn't? Is that?
I'll go beyond that. I'll say that the federal government being so dysfunctional makes the stakes that much higher for us at the state level. We have to protect the state of New York and set an example for the rest of the nation. This is, after all, the great state of New York, the Empire State. And when they start firing hundreds of scientists and overturning really solid law on the environment at the national level, it falls to the states to pick up the slack. And so we're trying to do that.
I mean, a perfect example with that with regard to water quality in particular is emerging chemicals. The federal government should be setting standards for these chemicals, and they haven't. And because of that, the state has had to jump into the breach, and we've got recommendations that have been made. We're waiting for the health department to still act here. But, you know, a perfect example of where the federal government fails to act, and the state has to fill in to address a policy area that the federal government should be addressing.
You know, a lot of this leadership in terms of Long Island's environment has been led by you both. Let's take a look at some of your speeches during this past legislative session.
So this is an historic moment. First passage of a constitutional amendment that should be part of the basic citizenship of every citizen of this great state. As you can see, it has passed in the Senate. Our passage of it here today is just moments away. I think that this is an expression of optimism that is good news in a time when our state is assaulted by climate change, by storms that should come once in a century that arrive every 3 or 4 years, by the invasion of the southern pine beetle, by all of the ravages of change. People need to know and be assured that we in the legislature are not going to be conceited to think that only we should manage the environment, but that in fact citizens have a participatory expectation and right. I am very pleased that we are about to pass this bill. This proposal is based on the premise that the right to clean air and clean water and a healthful environment is an elementary part of living in this great state. I am pleased to vote yes and recommend to my colleagues that they also support this measure.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. To explain my vote on this budget bill, specifically on the plastic bag ban, first of all, there can be no doubt, it's self-evident, the environmental benefits, the quality of life benefits that come from this particular piece of legislation, particularly with regard to the marine environment. In my district, I have more coastline than any other district, more of that marine environment. And I think that's one of the reasons that towns and villages in my district, long before this legislation, by local law, had already voted and already had instituted bans on plastic bags. And the county of Suffolk, my county, also followed suit with a fee on plastic bags and on paper bags. And the reason why my towns, my villages, my counties did this is that they hoped that one day it would spur the state of New York to take the action that it's taking today. I should point out that Suffolk County, many years ago, was the first county also to institute a bottle bill, hoping that the state would take action, and they did. As far as people's behavior and the adjustment to this legislation, in my district where have been bans in place, it was a very, very short period of time before people changed their behavior. I go to the grocery store a couple of times a week. I've got my reusable bags, and people quickly adjusted to that. That's what they do. And there was no great upheaval with regard to that kind of change in behavior. So I look forward to the implementation of this legislation, and I think we will reap the benefits for decades to come. I withdraw my request and vote in the affirmative.
Our children, they are the future. They are our hope for everything in our lives. And to have them exposed to poisons, substances, to harmful materials as they play is a sin. We have a measure before us that, as Mr. Ortiz has already indicated, we have worked on as a conference for many years. We're about to take the step, because I see that it has passed in the Senate, the step to send this to the governor's desk and thereby better protect the next generation and the future of our state. I very proudly vote yes.
Not only is tourism a major economic driver for Long Island, but we also have a very viable commercial fishing industry on Long Island, not just the commercial fishing industry, but also a recreational fishing industry. And the proposal for offshore drilling is incompatible with those industries. The federal proposal is inconsistent, not just with our economy, but also with our environment. One of these two things where the environment and the economy intersect. And I was one of those legislators who sat in on the public hearing, and I think I was there for most of those 10 hours. This was one of those cases where, regardless of your political persuasion, all opposed this proposal. And New York State should be doing its best to thwart this proposal. Yes, there's a Commerce Clause, but those powers not given to the federal government are retained by the state. And protecting our environment, protecting our water quality, protecting our communities is part of that authority. This is a great piece of legislation, and I'll be voting in the affirmative.
The topic is also the future of the state, the nation, and the global environment. Climate change is adversely affecting the economic well-being and public resources of the state of New York, with increased severity and frequency of extreme weather events, flooding events, heat waves, and other adversities that cause a direct negative impact upon our citizens. If we do not address this, and this measure before us is something we've seen before, this institution has voted 3 years in a row to address this issue. But if we do not, then we will not be serving well the needs of the people of the state. Just to place it in perspective, the 10 hottest years on record are the last 10 years. There have been more than 410 months of consecutive heat that is in excess of the average since 1880. In fact, the last 5 years have been the warmest 5 years in history, and of the last 22 years, 20 of those years have seen excessive heat conditions. It is an inescapable trend. It is not something that we can ignore or deny. In fact, this measure before us is an attempt to do what we believe is a first step in what is a journey that will involve many steps going forward. But I'm pleased that we have this before us and gives us an opportunity this evening to take this very important first step and make it into law.
Now, you're the chairman of the Committee on Local Government in the Assembly. You're the Assembly Chairman of Environmental Conservation. What's on your agenda? What's your priority? What's Long Island need, in your view? Why don't we start with you?
Well, you know, certainly with regard to, you know, to the environment, I think of a lot of our priorities, you know, Steve and I worked on as part of the budget, and that was additional money for water quality, capital money, an additional $500 million, the full funding of the Environmental Protection Fund. And as Steve mentioned, and something he should be taking full credit for, is the institution of the ban on plastic bags. So that was a good start, just coming right out of the budget process.
Is there a problem, an environmental problem, with the ban on plastic bags because of the potential impact on paper bags? Is that a concern or it isn't?
It's always a concern when people don't recycle and reuse, and they should be carrying their own bags. So it is wasteful to allow the paper bag proliferation to occur, which could happen. There is a local option out for local municipalities if they don't want to charge the nickel for the use of a paper bag.
So it's voluntary.
It's voluntary. At the county level, they can opt out. And it does create a lack of continuity. But we're very pleased to do the first part. If this takes a couple of steps to reach our ultimate goal of encouraging everyone to bring their own bag when they go shopping, I know that it's worth it just to make this advance.
Sure.
It took us, we passed this bill 3 years in a row in the Assembly before finally getting it accomplished in the budget this year.
Right.
So I'd like to go back in time a little bit and talk about how you both got started in your careers that have really brought you together more than once. So can we kind of go way back when, and maybe we'll start with you, Assemblyman Thiele, if you can talk about how you got started.
Well, I you know, government was and public policy was something that I knew I wanted to do from a very, very young age. I got the opportunity to work as an intern in the state assembly in 1975. I was a college junior, and that's where when I went from that something I knew I was interested in, thought I wanted to do, to something that I knew this was my calling. This is what I had a passion for. And I went to law school and got a law degree, but government was always on my mind, and you know, served as a municipal attorney in Southampton and East Hampton, and got the chance to run for office for the first time in 1987. I ran for the county legislature, and I won, and lo and behold, who was already there? But Steve Englebright.
And you came out of education, did you not?
I came out of academia. I was fascinated with the Pine Barrens, the oldest, arguably the oldest terrestrial ecosystem in the state, and an ancient ecosystem with tens of millions of years of history. So as a geologist, I found it fascinating to see how this grouping of plants and animals had adapted to what had been a barren landscape relatively recently in geologic time. And that brought me into the world of advocacy, because I saw people being contemptuous of the Pine Barrens, almost happy that they were being destroyed. And I said, wait a second, you know, there's more to this. And so that drew me in. And of course, another issue that drew Fred and I toward working together was our mutual opposition to the Shoreham nuclear power plant, which seemed at the time to be impossible to stop. It turns out it was not impossible, but
it was tough.
It was tough.
Wasn't easy. That's for sure.
But we've done a lot of work over the years on protecting the environment and protecting and preserving the landscape and quality of life of the eastern half of this island.
We're going to take a brief visit to the Pine Barrens. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
the Long Island Pine Barrens. Let's protect them. We're back, and we're talking to Assemblymen Stephen Englebright and Fred Thiele on the latest environmental stories to arise during the 2019 legislative session.
So perhaps Long Island's number one problem is the precipitous decline in water quality due to wastewater and nitrogen in wastewater and fertilizers that are going into our aquifer beneath our feet. What can and should the role of the state of New York be in addressing that? Because the remediation is going to cost billions of dollars. So Assemblyman Thiele, can you comment on
that?
Yeah,
I think it's kind of a three parts that the state needs to be involved in. And one is you have to have a plan. And, there's been a lot of work being done, whether it's a nitrogen reduction plan, for example, that the state has helped to fund and is underway. So you have to have a plan to address this problem. Secondly, you have to have the technology necessary and new technology, and for example, with regard to septic waste. And I think the state's role there has been, working with Stony Brook University, has set up a center to try to develop new technologies to deal with water quality issues. And once you have a plan and once you have the technology, you got to be able to pay for it. And so the third part of it, I think, is to either provide funding or provide the mechanisms by which funding can be generated to pay for all of this.
And actually, both of you gentlemen have actually spoken extensively on this issue with the Clean Water Partnership's annual What Are We Going to Do conference. Why don't we take a look?
It's so good to be home. This time yesterday, I was still in Albany, wishing I was here. So it's so wonderful to be with you this beautiful day. We began with a commitment in the executive budget, and we built on that, and that it was done cooperatively across the aisle. Senator Kemp Hannan, I particularly want to take note of, was extraordinary in his contribution to the conversation. And what we ended up with was an enhancement. $2 billion became $2.5 billion, and the particulars really matter. So let me share that list of particulars with you. When the dust settled, $1 billion for the 2017 Water Infrastructure Improvement Act is targeted to help municipalities upgrade their drinking and wastewater infrastructure. $355 million is for clean water infrastructure projects after 2021, $245 million for water quality improvement projects generally, $200 million, as I've mentioned, is for wastewater and infrastructure and drinking water improvements in New York City's watershed, $150 million for intermunicipal water and infrastructure grants. I'm pleased that part of what the Senate and Assembly joined to make sure was inserted was $110 million for land acquisition projects for source water protection. $100 million was identified for municipal water quality infrastructure programs. $130 million for drinking water remediation and mitigation of contaminated drinking water. The next one is $75 million for upgrades and replacements of septic systems and cesspools. That's a direct result of your work. Congratulations. Thank you all.
What we've accomplished so far are some small steps finally heading in the right direction. That is where we are with water quality at this time. We're looking at a problem where our trend of water quality has been declining for decades. It is not going to be reversed in 1 year, in one legislative session. It's going to take a commitment for decades. It's going to take a financial commitment, and it's going to be something that we have to be dedicated to for a long, long time. We've made some significant first steps. On the East End, last year, 80% of the people in the five East End towns voted to tax themselves for another 20 years and voted to set aside 20% of those dollars for water quality improvement projects. The state followed suit with the program that Assemblyman Englebright talked about. $75 million set aside just for septic system replacements. The town of East Hampton is taking a leadership role. They have the first legislation moving forward to implement septic system replacement. So we're making good first steps. We need to give voters the opportunity to make a decision on the county level about a recurring, continuous revenue stream for water quality. And then finally, stop repeating the mistakes of the past. I'm going to give you one example. It's in the town of Southampton, my hometown. There's a proposal right now for a change of zone, a down zone, that would, right in the middle of the central Pine Barrens, that would increase density and build a golf course. On its face, it makes no sense. We have to be rejecting these kinds of plans. We can't be spending public dollars. We can't, on the one hand, be spending public dollars saying we need to clean up the mistakes of the past, while at the same time we continue to make them. I thank you for all the efforts that you have made. You know, when it's the leadership that has really come locally that has made the difference for us in Albany, and has made the difference, I think, in town halls and in the county government. So I thank you for the efforts that you've made, and I look forward to continuing to work with you in the future. Thank you.
Very educational speeches. We've been talking to assembly members of Fred Thiele and Steve Englebright. Keep up the good work, guys. Join us again next time when we talk about fire in the Pine Barrens. I'm Dick Amper.
And I'm Kathleen Nasta. See you next time.
Thanks for watching.
Water quality is declining, and there's a major push to clean it up. All of our water comes from underground aquifers. What gets into the ground gets into what we drink, cook with, and bathe our children in. It also contaminates the places where we swim, boat, and fish. Here's something we can all do at home to help. We all use cleaning fluids and other chemical products like paint thinners and degreasers. These products can be harmful to humans and animals and are turning up in our groundwater. Be sure to read labels of the products you purchase and don't buy toxic chemical products at all. Use eco-friendly, non-toxic, and natural substitutes. Vinegar is great to clean your floors, and add baking soda for a great drain cleaner. Finally, don't pour caustic chemicals down the drain. Instead, take them to your local stop disposal site. Not only will this help to protect Long Island's water, but it will also be a learning experience for your children and family. Remember, protecting Long Island's water starts at home.
The Long Island Pine Barrens. Let's protect them.